بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
ألف لام ميم.
تلك آيات الكتاب الحكيم، هدى ورحمة للمحسنين.
ألف لام ميم.
These are the verses of the wise book, a guide and a mercy for those who do ihsan, those who do beautiful deeds, those who establish salah and give zakah, and they believe in the hereafter with certainty. Now three deeds are mentioned over here for these muhsinin. Who are they? We also think that, oh, Allah knows how pure I am and how much I love Him, and Allah doesn't need me to prove it. Let's analyze ourselves. Who are the muhsinin? Those who establish salah, number one. Number two, those who give zakat. They worship Allah, they fulfill Allah's rights, and they fulfill people's rights. And they have yaqeen in the hereafter. Now this word yaqeen is very important because we need to compare it to the following ayah. Such are on guidance from their Lord, and such are the successful. Now who is someone who has yaqeen? If a student has certainty that his exam is the next day, what's that student going to do? Is he going to waste time watching a movie or listening to some music? No, he'll be busy studying. He won't waste a single moment lest he suffers for that in the exam. So we need to remember that those who have certainty in the hereafter do not waste a single moment of this precious life. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهُوَ الْحَدِيثِ. Of mankind is he who purchases idle talks. لِيُضِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلَ اللَّهِ. So he can misguide others from the path of Allah. بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Without knowledge. وَيَتَّخِذَهَا هُزُوًا. And he takes it as a joke. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُهِينٌ. For such will be a humiliating torment. And when our verses are recited to such a one, he turns away in pride, as if he heard them not, as if there were deafness in his ear. So announce to him a painful torment. Now what is meant by this lahw al-hadith? Lahw al-hadith means everything trivial, everything worthless, everything which occupies one to the exclusion of important tasks. See, the origin of this ayat is very important to understand. That when the Meccans were doing their best to dissuade the Muslims from following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what happened was that this man called Nasr bin Haris came up to the Meccans, the Quraysh leaders, and said, you know, you're going about it the wrong way. This is not the way you can distract people from Allah and from listening to the Quran. So the best way to do it is, and he went to Iran and he brought back with him stories, and he brought back dancing girls and singing girls. And then whenever he would see people are going to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he'd tell them, why are you going to the Prophet? He's just going to tell you to fast and pray and put you in difficulty. Come and listen to this, you know, song instead. And come and listen to these amazing stories. In other words, he came up with a whole culture of entertainment to distract people from obeying Allah. Now when the scholars were asked about this ayat, Ibn Masud radiallahu anhu said, who is one of the great commentators, said, by Allah it refers to singing. And he said this three times. So in the same way we find a hadith as well. In one hadith the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the gist of which was, I have been sent in this world to break every musical instrument. Musical instruments are totally haram. There's only one exception, and that's the daf. Now what about songs and singing? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I forbade two voices which are sinfully shameless. One, a voice singing to the accompaniment of musical instruments. Someone who is singing with music playing in the background, that's haram. And these are the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What form of singing is allowed then? Occasionally we find that if the words of the song are not haram, they're not sinful, they're not shameless, they're not satanic, then you're allowed to sing, but without music. Now, what other connotations does lahw al-hadith have? Lahw al-hadith in this day and age could be our television programs, which are useless, worthless. Again, I wouldn't say that TV is haram. It depends on what you're watching. If you're watching the Discovery Channel, that's much more different than if you're watching Santa Barbara, for instance. Then you have fiction. And again, in fiction, you have trashy fiction, and you have fiction that's distracting you, and whether it's the latest bestsellers. Then you have movies, and the same applies. If you're learning a message from the movie, if for instance you have Islamic videos or you have documentaries, then that's fine. Then you have computer and video games. Alright, what happens in computer and video games? You have the violent games in which the children are killing everyone they can, or you have the PlayStation. What happens in all of these games? And all these music and movies and television programs, why is it forbidden? What's the big deal? Allah tells us. مِنَ النَّاسِ, amongst mankind. Now we need to listen to this ayat very carefully. مَنْ يَشْتَرِي is one who buys لَهْوَ الْحَدِيثِ. Things like this. Now why does Allah say he buys? In other words, that's what he likes to spend his money on. He's got his pocket allowance, oh let me go and buy that latest CD which is just out. Would he consider giving that money for a sadaqah? I don't think so. Would he consider giving that money to help someone out in need? No, because his CD is more important. So Allah says he buys lahwal hadith. In other words, he has a collection, a movie collection, a CD collection and a fiction collection, and a computer and video game collection. So what's the harm in that? They're just having a good time, aren't they? Allah tells us, لِيُضِلَّ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, so that they can be misguided from the path of Allah. He can misguide from the deen of Allah. I'll talk about myself. I've been through a phase when I was addicted to music. The first thing I do in the morning is get up, switch on my CD player. And of course I had to have CDs. Audio cassettes weren't good enough for me. And then I'd watch my movie, and then I'd read my book, and I'd have a great day. Now I thought I was a really good Muslim because I was praying my five prayers regularly. What I didn't realize was that when I was praying, my mind was on the book that I'd just been reading, on the song that I'd just been listening to, that tune would be playing through my mind constantly. And when I finish, I wouldn't be interested in reading the Quran because the Quran is so heavy. Why don't I read something light instead? And why don't I unwind with a movie instead? So deen becomes boring. Now that's the least of what can happen when you get involved in this addictive culture, because it's addictive, there's no other word for it. Giving up music was one of the most difficult things for me. لِيُضِلَّ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, simply distracts you from the path of Allah. The Quran becomes boring, a hadith become boring, and who's got time for crying before Allah when there's so many more exciting things you can do? What are the more extreme effects of this culture of entertainment? The more extreme effect is that your social behavior is impaired. Your brain is absorbing all the messages you're receiving. See, we find that amongst music, the worst kind of music you can listen to is heavy metal. Because heavy metal music generally, in fact, invariably carries with it satanic messages. And you might say, no, I've never heard any satanic message. And they do that by means of backtracking. So if you listen to the tape backwards, you realize what they're really saying is sick things like, I worship Satan and Satan is my Lord. And you listen to this tape called The Shadows, in which they've given you examples of this. We find that computer and video games are addictive as well. Now, if you're playing the violent games, what happens? You need that constant excitement in your life. You get this craving to have power. See, the Columbine killings that took place, those two students that killed all those other students, they were addicted to this computer game. Why? Because they were used to killing people, so life for them was virtual reality. If they could kill people on screen, heck, why can't we kill people otherwise? لِيُضِلَّ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, deen becomes irrelevant. The Quran, a boring old book. A hadith, fiction. Something that's not relevant for me today. So Allah says, بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, without knowledge. Why without knowledge? You're living in a fantasy world. A fantasy world, you've created a mindset for yourself. A sea of triviality in which you're drowning and you don't even realize it. And what happens? وَيَتَّخِذَهَا هُزُوَى. And you start making fun of deen. Because Islam isn't cool, and it's not cool to wear hijab, and it's not cool to read the Quran. So hey, I'm not into this stuff. يَتَّخِذَهَا هُزُوَى. You start making fun of it. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُهِينٌ. For such people, Allah has not said whether they're Muslims or non-Muslims. For such people, there will be a humiliating torment. Why? Why is the punishment so severe? Because when Allah had given us the music of the Quran, when Allah had given us the music of the birds in the universe, and the music that is all around us, when Allah had given us stories of the Quran, and stories of the hadith, then how dare we despise this Quran and turn to other sources for our own amusement and entertainment? See, there's this book called Amusing Ourselves to Death, and in that the author, Neil Postman, concludes that the problem is not that people are laughing, the problem is people don't know what they're laughing about or why they've stopped thinking. That's it, we've just stopped thinking, we don't have time to think anymore. We're too busy watching our favorite programs, listening to our favorite music. Allah warns us of the results of this action. For such is a humiliating torment. When our verses are recited to such a one, he turns away in pride as if he heard them not. We switch on the TV, we see that Maulvi Saab, and what do? We change the channel. As if there were deafness in his ear. فَبَشِّرْهُ بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. So give him good news. This is divine sarcasm. Give him good news of a painful torment. He didn't want to face reality? Fine, but he'll certainly taste reality on that day. Indeed, those who believe and do good deeds, for them are gardens of delight to abide therein. Wa'ada Allahi haqqa. It is a promise of Allah in truth. And He is the Almighty, the All-Wise. People say, oh, I can't give up music. If I could give up music, I think everyone can. I remember the day that I decided that I was going to reduce my music intake because I was so addicted I couldn't give it up altogether. So what I did was I had one day of the week where I'd just be listening to music, and the whole day I was listening to music. And then one day I decided I was going to burn my CDs. So I burned 50 CDs or 50, 60 CDs. And I felt like I was smashing the idols in my heart. And when my husband came home, I ran up to him and I said, you know, I burnt all my CDs. And he said, have you gone mad? Allah says that you have to do this for Allah's sake. Indeed, those who believe and do good deeds reject lahw al-hadith. It's not that difficult. Allah makes it easy for you. For them are gardens of delight. Wouldn't we rather have that Jannah than have a few moments of bliss or relaxation on this earth? To abide therein, it is a promise of Allah in truth. And He is the Almighty, the All-Wise. He has created the heavens without any pillars that you see, and has set on the earth firm mountains, lest it should shake with you. And He has scattered therein moving creatures of all kinds. And we send down water from the sky, and we cause plants of every goodly kind to grow therein. Hadha khalqullah. This is the creation of Allah. But we don't have time to notice. We don't have time to observe it. So show me that which those besides Him have created. No, the wrongdoers are in plain error. وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةَ أَنِ اشْكُرْ لِلَّهِ. Indeed, we bestowed upon Luqman wisdom, saying, give thanks to Allah. This is the core of wisdom, that you thank Allah. How do we thank Allah? Just by saying, thank you, Allah? No, by using our faculties, using our eyes, ears, and minds for the purpose for which He created us. Whoever gives thanks, he gives thanks for his own self. He's not doing Allah any favor. And whoever is ungrateful, then indeed Allah is all rich, free of all needs, worthy of all praise. Allah doesn't need our ibadah. Remember when Luqman said to his son, when he was advising him, who is this Luqman? Some say prophet, some say wise man. We find that the Arabs revered his tradition and would constantly quote him. So Allah was telling them, well, this is what your own wise man used to say. Remember when Luqman said to his son when he was advising him, you know, the advice that a father gives his son will always be sincere. It will always be the essence of his own experiences. What was the teaching that he gave him? Oh my son, join not in worship others with Allah, whether your own nafs or your friends or your society or your desires. Indeed, shirk is a great wrong indeed. People say, we don't do shirk. Every time we obey ourselves rather than obeying Allah, we are doing shirk. And we have enjoined a man to be good to his parents. His mother bore him in weakness, weakness upon weakness, and his weaning is in 2 years. Anishkurli wali walidayk wa ilayyal masir. Give thanks to me and to your parents, but to me is the final destination. Right after Allah, Allah mentions our parents' right. Be good to them, but remember that you're coming back to me. And if they both strive with you to make you join in worship with me, others, that of which you have no knowledge, then do not obey them. People say, oh, my mother doesn't let me. We're not allowed to obey anyone if they're telling us to disobey Allah. وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Behave with them kindly in the world. And follow the path of Him who turns to me in repentance and in obedience. إِلَيَّ مَرْجِعُكُمْ. Then to me will be your return, and I shall tell you what you used to do. يَا بُنَيَّ. O my son, if it be anything equal to the weight of a grain of mustard seed, and though it be in a rock, or in the heavens, or in the earth, Allah will bring it forth. Nothing is hidden from Him. Indeed, Allah is subtle, well aware. O my son, establish salah, enjoin on people all that is good, and forbid people from all that is evil, and bear with patience whatever befalls you. We're not supposed to be selfishly concentrating on ourselves. We're supposed to care for others as well, and care about their guidance. Indeed, these are some of the most important commandments. وَلَا تُسَعِرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَمْشِ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحَا. And do not turn your face away from men with pride, nor walk in insolence through the earth. Indeed, Allah does not like any arrogant boaster. See, sometimes when people turn towards deen and they start preaching deen, they become very self-righteous. And they get this holier-than-thou attitude, that I am so great and I love Allah so much. Allah is saying no. No arrogance is allowed. Do not walk in insolence throughout the earth. Waqsid fi mashyik, and be moderate in your gait. Why is the gait mentioned over here? See, our gait symbolizes what we really think about ourselves. So if you look at the way a rich man walks or the way a poor man walks, you'll see there's a difference. And the difference is in their own perceptions of themselves. Allah says, be moderate in your walking. Don't be arrogant, don't strut around, and lower your voice. Indeed, the harshest of all voices is the braying of the donkeys. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes intensely that any person should be raising their voice and screaming unnecessarily. Do you not see that Allah has subjected for you whatsoever is in the heavens and whatsoever is in the earth, and has completed and perfected His graces upon you both, apparent and hidden? We can't even count Allah's mercies upon us. We don't even know of all the times Allah saves us from disaster. Yet of mankind is he who disputes about Allah without knowledge or guidance or a book-giving light. And when it is said to them, follow that which Allah has sent out, they say, no, we shall follow that which we found our fathers following. Even if shaitan is inviting them to the torment of the fire. See, people who are so engrossed in love al hadith, they're so engrossed in this entertainment culture, they don't have time to study the Quran. They don't have time to figure out true Islam for themselves. So they'll just accept the traditions that their fathers have taught them. وَمَنْ يُسْلِمْ وَجْهَهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ Whoever surrenders his face to Allah, his being, his core to Allah, while he is one who does good, فَقَدْ اِسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى He has grasped the most trustworthy handhold, which will not break. And to Allah return all matters for decision. And whoever disbelieves, let not his disbelief grieve you. To us is their return, and we shall inform them what they have done. Indeed, Allah is the all-knower of what is in the hearts of men. We let them enjoy for a little while, then in the end we shall oblige them to enter a great torment. And if you ask them, who has created the heavens and the earth? They will certainly say, Allah. قُلِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ Say, all praises belong to Allah, but most of them do not have knowledge. To Allah belongs whatsoever is in the heavens and the earth. إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ Indeed, Allah is rich, worthy of all praise. وَلَوْ أَنَّ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَامٍ وَالْبَحْرُ يَمُدُّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ مَا نَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ If all the trees on the earth were pens, just imagine, and all the sea was ink, with seven seas behind it to add to its supply, still the words of Allah would not be exhausted. Do we find Allah boring? We find this Quran boring? We are not ready for Allah? We are too young for Allah? This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Nur of samawati wal ard, the light of the heavens and the earth. There is none like Him. What are we busy reading? We all know the answer. Inna Allaha azizun hakeem. Indeed Allah is almighty, all wise. Ma khalqukum wala ba'thukum illa ka nafsin wahida. The creation of all of you and the resurrection of all of you are only as a single person. Indeed, Allah is all hearer, all seer. It's as easy for Him to resurrect the whole of creation as it is for Him to resurrect one person. Do you not see that Allah merges the night into the day and merges the day into the night and has subjected the sun and the moon, each running its course for a term appointed, and that Allah is all aware of what you do? ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْحَقُّ وَأَنَّ مَا يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِهِ الْبَاطِلِ This is because Allah, He is the truth. And that which they invoke besides Him is false. And that Allah, He is the Most High, He is the Most Great. Do you not see that the ships sail through the sea by Allah's grace, that He may show you of His signs? إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِكُلِّ صَبَّرٍ شَكُورٍ Indeed, in this are signs for every patient, grateful person. وَإِذَا غَشِيَهُمْ مَوْجٌ And when a wave covers them like shade, they invoke Allah, making their du'as for Him only. But when He brings them safe to land, there are among them those that stop in between. وَمَا يَجْحَدُ بِآيَاتِنَا إِلَّا كُلُّ خَطَّارٍ كَفُورٍ None denies our signs except every ungrateful person. Now we can decide which we want to be, an ingrate or someone who's grateful. Ya ayyuha an-nas, ittaqoo rabbakum. O mankind, wake up. What are you doing? O mankind, fear your Lord. Be conscious of Allah. Know that He is watching you. Wakhshaw yawma, and fear a day when no father can do anything for his son, nor a son do anything for his father. We shouldn't rely upon our children that, oh, our children are very good and they'll pray for us. Or we shouldn't rely upon our parents that, oh, my mother was very good and she reads the Quran all day long and she's praying for me, so I don't need to do anything for myself. Fear a day when no father can do anything for his son, nor a son do anything for his father. Inna wa'adallahi haq.
Indeed, the promise of Allah is true. فَلَا تَغُرَّنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورُ. Then let not this present life deceive you. And that's what Lahv al-Hadith is all about. It just amuses us and distracts us and just takes our mind off what's really going to happen to us. Nor let the chief deceiver, Shaitan, deceive you about Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ. Indeed Allah, with Him alone is the knowledge of the hour. He sends down the rain and knows that which is in the wombs. No person knows what he will earn tomorrow, and no person knows in what land he will die. Now many people read this ayat and object, well, Allah claims that only He knows, you know, what is in the wombs, and we have the ultrasound machine. Firstly, we need to know that in this ayah we find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is claiming sole knowledge for two things. That indeed Allah with Him alone is the knowledge of the hour, and no person knows in what land he will die. And this is something which none of us know. We don't know when we're going to die, and we do not know when the day of judgment is going to take place. Now the second thing we need to understand is that we shouldn't just pass superficial judgments on an ayat that we read. No person knows whether they bear a mu'min or a kafir in their wombs. No one knows whether they're bearing a Hitler or a Hassan Basri in their wombs. No ultrasound machine can tell you that. And as a radiologist once told me, that only if Allah allows me can the baby's position be such that I can tell the sex of the child. He says, when my own wife was expecting, till the last day of the 9th month, I was trying to find out what she's going to have, and the baby's position was such I couldn't. So we shouldn't just pass superficial judgments. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. Remember, Allah is both all-knowing and well-acquainted.
Turn to Allah, He's never far away. Put your trust in Him, raise your hands and pray. Ooh yeah, Allah, guide my steps, don't let me go astray. You're the only one who can show me the way. Show me.